Welcome to
Take off your pod and cast it.
I'm Ken Edwards.
And I'm Ripley. And today we have
the illustrious, the phenomenal, the known to this podcast feed if you're an oldie, if you're a stan.
Same feed?
Yeah.
Good shit.
Yeah, built-in audience, baby. This isn't just a new season.
This is we got Patrick Miller here, everybody.
You know him, you love him. We're not talking Green Day, Patty. But while we're at it.
No, we're talking 96? I thought this was 97.
Yeah, no, this is 96.
Interesting. I was thinking about where Green Day was when Blink-182 was starting their ascent here, which is really here where just I think they
Insomniac,
start their ascent.
Right?
Uh-huh. And Insomniac had come out and been a big disappointment, probably for being so fucking depressing.
Right. And like angrier.
Right. Yeah, it's a depressing and angry album. So it would make sense that a band like Blink-182 would be on the ascent with this album coming out next year.
Yeah, taking the 96 slot of the pop punk.
Yeah, because the only other pop punk album I can think of that's as iconic from this year is even more depressing than Insomniac, which would be Dear You.
Oh,
by
wow.
Jawbreaker.
Yeah.
So here's your option. You have this band that's being billed as like the thinking man's Green Day. And then Blink-182, who's been branded the thinking man's no one.
The non-thinking Green Day.
Yeah. We actually discussed Jawbreaker a lot in the first episode because we didn't realize until we played them side by side how much of an influence they clearly were.
Yeah, on even, Cheshire Cat, yeah.
Yeah, I would think even like the guitar tone on something like Unfun is pretty similar to what they're doing on Buddha and Cheshire Cat. And I mean, they're a three-piece pop punk band.
And we listened to Want with the like sort of droning guitar and the bass
really
happening.
Clicky bouncy bass.
Yeah.
The bass chords, yeah.
Yeah, I mean the thing about Jawbreaker though is like Adam, their drummer, was always being pretty highlighted in their music. And then when I was listening to this, I was thinking about how on those first couple Blink-182 albums, it's really Tom's guitar that is supposed to be the main focus. And then this is kind of the last album where Tom being kind of a wizard on the fretboard is a huge focus of the music of this band, as opposed to, because they get that kind of ace in the hole drummer after this.
Yeah, it's a weird similarity in the early Green Day with the new drummer and the, as Ripley pointed out last week, with not showing off after a couple albums as guitar players, Tom and Billy Joe.
Yeah, so I wanted to do the Dude Ranch episode in particular. I've kind of always gone down as saying on record that it's my favorite album by Blink-182, and that's probably never going to change. They would have to put out a new album that I like more than Dude Ranch for that to be the case.
What's your relationship to Blink-182? Like, where do you stand on them now? Where did you stand on them when you first heard them?
Well, like, I think I either...
Wait, if I could rephrase the question. What was the first time you heard of Blink-182?
I definitely knew the song Damn It before I put a band to it. But then I think it was the song All the Small Things What's My Age Again, where somebody said, this is Blink-182. Mm. And then going back and realizing, oh, they also do that other song I like a lot. But I think it was really like around the time the singles for Enema of the State were coming out. And Enema of the State was not out yet. And so I remember buying like a CD single of What's My Age Again that had a bunch of live tracks from Dude Ranch on it. I think they do like Josie and maybe one other Dude Ranch song as like a B-side live. And so I got Dude Ranch. And like my parents were really weird about letting me buy CDs with PMRC stickers on it. Totally fine with me buying a CD with a huge nutsack on it and a song called Dick Lips.
I was wondering, we're looking at the Spotify cover right now. Is that edited? Did they edit out a giant or nutsack, or is
No, you just can't see it as well. Just,
goddamn Spotify ruining album art. You can barely see the nutsack.
So Dude Ranch was the first album?
Absolutely, yes. That was definitely the first album by them I owned, which is probably why it holds the most special place in my heart. It is my favorite, like by far. There's a lot of things that make it, for me, better. This is the last time for a little while they sing about being guys their age, like their own age.
Mm. Yeah.
All of these songs, with the exception of the aforementioned Dick Lips, are about young adulthood. They're not about high school. Yeah, they're not relatable to, for whatever reason, like they were not as relatable to me as like a 12-year-old or however old I was when I got it. I would have been even younger. Yeah,
Scott was still in high school for this.
That's
one.
That's wild. But yeah, Tom and Mark are writing songs about being young adults. But then for the next two albums, all their songs were like about being a teenager.
I think the first video of theirs I saw was First Date, and it never hit me until years later how weird it is that after they got older, they were like writing about these like really childish things.
You know, I always thought that, but like they're not that much older. They were 23 and 24.
Uh-huh.
They would take off their pants and jacket.
Yeah.
Yeah, they were still young guys, but this is about being out of school and like even like Carousel on Cheshire Cat is literally about being like out of high school and listless, and like that was what they sang about. Yeah, but then like even like what Damn It, the video for Damn It. No, the video for Josie, they're in high school in it, but it's like funny because they're like, oh, we're doing it like the teen high school comedy. But then they decide to just make two albums where that is the motif.
Yeah, I just watched it earlier that like, it's sort of the whole gag the whole time is look how old these dudes look to be doing this shit.
Yeah, I really kind of like the dumb guy having to be, I guess this is growing up feeling of the album.
Absolutely.
It's interesting. I've never made this comparison before, but you putting it that way, I think Weezer went through a similar thing of like them just doing everything sincerely and people labeling them nerds and then being like, oh, that's why we got successful. Now let's like try to cash in on this weird nerd energy.
Yeah.
Oh, but they did. Both did and continue to.
So when did you start to feel less interested in them, if that ever happened?
It did. Like I think by the time they made the self-titled album, I was already into darker music than Blink-182 was ever gonna write. But that was the first time I saw them, was they were touring that album.
Where'd you see them?
Oh, that was the best. It's gone down as like the best show I've ever been to in my life, because it was like Hoobastank, Stain, Puddle of Mud, AFI was opening because Sing the Sorrow had just come out.
Korn, right?
Yeah, Korn headlined. They were touring either the one after Untouchables, I think is what they did, or what they were touring, and The Offspring of Blink-182. Fucking sick.
It was an HFS holiday show.
Yeah,
right?
It was HFS Miss
WHFS, 2000. Man.
Yeah, rip.
I mean, that's where I first heard Blink-182.
It had to have been on that or DC-101. Yeah. And then, yeah, finding out that they had this, like, very, very juvenile energy from the, like, that was what obviously I think hooked me in as like a,
all of us, yeah.
Yeah, as like a 10. I was genuinely had to, if Enema came out when I was in like 98, right?
99.
Okay, yeah. So I would have barely been breaking double digits with my fucking age when I first had this album.
Wow.
What was your age again? Dude Ranch was released in 1996 after MCA signed the band.
And you can hear that so immediately that they're on a major label.
Yeah.
You can hear that Cheshire Cat was Cheshire Cat was distributed by a major label. This is the first thing they recorded with that budget.
And the reason MCA decided to sign them was because Eminem's blew up in Australia on Australian radio.
Whoa.
So this album was pushed really hard in Australia and not so much in America. But at the time, MCA Records was not releasing anything very good, and was like the inside joke of the music industry was Musician Cemetery of America. It's where bands went to die. So this was their Hail Mary to get a new young band out. And Dude Ranch did it. It's a fantastic album.
Was this like a hit?
Yeah.
Like low key?
It went gold about 6 months after release.
Yeah, so. I mean, it had a really strong breakout single on it that broke them in America. You know, I couldn't even tell you if I've seen them play it live, but like I feel like it was an absolute staple from when this came out for at least like, 5 or 6 years in their live set.
I feel like they don't close with it.
I've seen them twice and I couldn't tell you if they have or not.
When was the other time you saw them?
I saw them with Matt Skiba at another like radio festival here in Richmond at like Innsbruck.
About California era, right?
It was, yeah. It was California era. It was right before California came out.
Which show was better?
That's very tough, because seeing the original lineup, but seeing them try to be serious.
Mm-hmm.
Which, by the way, like I think, yeah, this album is about young adulthood. It is not serious.
Right.
The self-titled is about adulthood, and they're still very dumb, which makes the seriousness kind of, it just never clicked for me.
That I'm very excited to get that one. That is my all time. It's probably my favorite album of all time.
So they just ended up playing, I don't know, like I Miss You wasn't as much of a meme as it was at this point. Like I definitely enjoyed seeing them play I Miss You the second time I saw them, even though it was Matt Skiba doing Where Are You?
That song does he not lay into work
it?
Live.
Does he like do a Tom? I mean, I guess he's
I don't know because all my friends and I were doing it. So I could not tell you what Matt Skiba sounded like. I mean, I just saw Matt Skiba. It's weird that the first time I ever saw him was with Blink-182 because I saw Alkaline Trio last week.
Whoa.
With Mikey. Yeah, with Bad Religion.
That rules. What a show.
Really fucking good show. I mean, Bad Religion was... I'd heard of Bad Religion through Blink-182. And like that's why Blink-182 and Green Day are so huge for me is because they turned me on to a lot of my favorite bands afterwards.
Definitely.
And like Bad Religion, it's very weird that Bad Religion was Blink-182's opener on the Enema of the State tour. Like, there's a whole album of like dick and fart jokes for children. And then like this band that's already pretty old, even at that point, you know, they were all probably in their 30s and singing about like atheism. But they had their last kind of Hail Mary album with the New America. Yeah. That was their last major label album. And it was probably the poppiest thing they ever did around that time. But yeah, I would say that the second time I saw them was more fun for me.
I get that. Wait, who played first, Bad Religion or Alkaline Trio?
Alkaline Trio. But it was definitely a co-headlining situation. I mean, Bad Religion did an encore, but I think it was only one song.
Mm, hell yeah.
So this album was mixed and mastered by Mark Trombino. This is the last album before they started working with Jerry Finn. And his previous work before this was... biggest one I noticed was Static Prevails by Jamie Eat World.
Okay. Oh, well, that would make a lot of sense.
Yeah, it makes a lot of
sense. I definitely heard of that band from Blink-182. And then... then they blew up, and that was one of my first bands where I was like, hey, I knew about this shit.
Yeah. Another band that he did was Knapsack. He had done Knapsack's first two albums. One of my favorite emo bands of all time. Really good band worth checking out. But I think he did a pretty good job. To celebrate the signing, the group held a party at the Hotel Del Coronado in San Diego. And Scott Rayner got really drunk. And jumped off a balcony and broke both his heels. So he recorded Dude Ranch in a wheelchair with two injured feet.
Whoa.
They're sat plagued. On a ledge, begged you to come down.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
Oh, they're plagued because, like, didn't Mark have, like, no voice when they recorded Buddha?
Yeah. Both Mark and Tom were having, you know, vocal issues. This album took 5 weeks compared to the 5 days that Cheshire Cat did. And... what I found out about the like broken feet thing, I was blown away because the drumming on this album is incredible. And I will say again, if he did not have to precede Travis Barker, he would be considered one of the best drummers in punk rock.
He's a little incessant for me.
There's actually some moments where I was like, oh, having Travis Barker on this would have made it better.
I agree.
I don't feel that way about much Blink-182. I've it makes sense for their career, I guess, and like the, I don't know, when has a flashy drummer ever like had commercial appeal? Like, has it ever really been that way before or after this band? Like, I really think of like Keith Moon's not even a flashy drummer. He's just all over the place the way that Travis Barker is all over the place. But like, it's like
Neil Peart, Rush.
Yeah, I suppose
not.
So, yeah.
The original drummer.
There you go.
Yeah,
but the guy who wrote all their hits.
Oh, for real.
Yeah, all Rush songs were, after he joined, were written by Neil Peart.
Yep.
So he's the one who's like reading Ayn Rand and shit, and writing fucking songs about it.
Uh-huh. I had a Rush phase a couple months ago and then read the lyrics and was no longer having a Rush phase.
That's why we listen to Rush, man, for the lyrics.
Last month I went and saw Primus, who's touring, and their tour is called A Tribute to Kings, and the second half of their set was the entire A Farewell to Kings album.
Yeah. What?
And since Rush doesn't tour anymore, you could tell like there was a bunch of Rush fans there too, like
just to see it.
Yeah, and I just heard old men talking shit afterwards of like, they're not, he's nothing compared to Geddy Lee. He can't even hit a note. It's like they did everything weirdly.
Yeah.
They're Primus,
it's
doing Rush.
Primus.
Yeah.
Did either of you have this album on CD?
Dude, yeah, definitely.
I got it after I was into them.
It was like silver with
there was like a gun on the CD itself.
Cool.
And the back had them like on a dude ranch in cowboy attire.
And the liner note's pretty funny. Jokes about like guns and dicks and stuff on it.
Yeah,
they did a whole photo shoot. They're on a dude ranch wearing cowboy hats and stuff, but they like look like shitty like young like punk skater kids. Like they like Tom has like a shitload of facial piercings. I remember that pretty clearly.
But it was like a fold out, and on one side you had the lyrics and the pictures and the liner notes and stuff, and on the other side was a poster that said "Greetings from the Blink 182 Dude Ranch." Mm-hmm. And it was a parody of the album cover of Greetings from Asbury Park.
Whoa.
By Springsteen. I would have to look at that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Let's pull it up. But I didn't realize that till like 2 hours ago and like shit my pants. Like it's Blink 182 and Springsteen. Those are my faves all around.
Oh, I see.
Yeah.
Very cool.
I couldn't picture it before, but yeah, I clearly had it.
Oh, I had it hanging in my wall. Yeah.
Hell yeah.
Yeah, I mean, let's get into it. Let's start with one of the best songs on the album, if not the best.
Let's do it. I know I'm pathetic, I knew when she said it. But these are the thoughts that she called me when I drove her home. There's no more waiting, you sure no more wasting. I've done all I can, but she still wants to be left alone. You got to help me out. And I'll try not to argue. No one likes a dropout. Mistakes are hard to undo.
I mean, I love that song. It comes in with like the solid repetitive riff. It comes to that like very easy to learn how to play. Like the drums are like kind of the best of like what Scott Rayner does, which is that sort of syncopated ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-
Yeah. The NoFX influence I didn't realize until recently, but there's a lot of it.
Yeah, I mean, that's big on a lot of songs, but the double vocals and everything, like Tom having a little more control of his voice on this album than he did previously.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm trying to remember, I haven't listened to Cheshire Cat in years, but I know that Buddha, he has kind of like a pretty, like, not much control over his voice. It's really, really whiny and mm-hmm. nasal. And then he has pretty scratchy voice on this album, but is it this scratchy on Cheshire Cat or no?
I think this is like the perfect mid-range between Cheshire Cat and then what he sounds like on Enema.
Absolutely, yeah. I agree. I mean, he just, it's kind of scratchy, so you have that like good contrast that I like in plenty. But I remember hearing like the Lawrence Arms for the first time and being like, Mark and Brendan have the exact same kind of vocal dynamic that Mark and Tom have, and it works really well.
So Mark has described this song as an abject self-pity in the face of a collapsed relationship, and Tom has said,
interesting and rare for a Blink-182 song written by Mark Hoppus.
Tom has said that this is about his relationship with his mother after he was kicked out of school for drinking.
I mean, they're both singing it.
Yeah.
It means different things to both of them, I guess.
No, I think that's really fucking cool.
It is, yeah.
The guitar riff in this song is fucking awesome.
Yeah. It's a good repetitive riff that you don't really get sick of.
Yeah. And, I mean, this album is the perfect opening track, I think. It starts off with so much energy and really doesn't lose it until 6 or 7 songs in.
Yeah. It is like a perfect opening track anthem for like punk rock with lyrics like, what is it? Don't pull me down. This is where I belong. Yeah. You shout that shit.
I think I'm different, but I'm the same and I'm right. It's just, this was like for like 12-year-old Ripley, this was my fucking jam.
Yeah.
Like, early teenage angst, tween angst. This shit was mind-blowing. Yeah.
Classic opener.
Yeah, I mean, there's not too much to say. It's just, it's good. Let's go into some pervert shit.
Yeah. let's start talking about the problematic shit.
Did anybody know what the word voyeur meant before they...
No, I didn't.
Yeah, of course not.
I really
didn't. We all learned it from this song.
Yep. I learned a lot of things from Blink-182 that I wish I didn't. Tomorrow, I need I'd eat her out if she was on my dinner plate. I mean, does it get any more poetic than that, Tom DeLonge?
My favorite part is the filthy white inbred.
Yeah.
That, I mean, good pervert song by Blink-182, playing it for laughs.
Yeah, track two, like reminding but you.
Musically, like really, really tight.
Yes.
And not as tight as they, you know, they were not that tight up until this point. That was like an issue, I think, with the band.
Yeah, they were sort of, they went too long on a lot of things on Cheshire Cat. Not too long, but they really like indulged.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, I think a big difference between Cheshire Cat and this one is that was a Tom song, but you've got Mark's And I Wish. And you can really start to see, I mean, from the beginning with Pathetic being a dueling song, but like a lot of these songs, you've got some real backing vocals from the other member.
Harmonizing.
And finally, it feels like this album was written together a lot more than Cheshire Cat does.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, yeah, there's just specific parts musically on this song where you're like, oh, this was worked out over a little period of time here where, you know, they hold for this little extra part after the first verse or they...
Yeah.
That like would sound like shit if you didn't practice.
Yeah, it's such a loony little line. It sounds comical even though it's just notes that work together. I think it's great. The outro is so specific, starting with the bass solo all the way through the end. It just like bass solo, then it rocks real hard, then it does the riff for real short, and then just ends real quick.
Yeah.
Rules.
I think that there are like older millennials and Gen X folks who like to talk about the concern that Zoomers have had so much like offensive, horrible, gross shit thrown at them from a young age because of the internet. And they forget that we had Blink-182. Like, whole lot of things I learned from this song.
Yeah, I could just buy gross pervert shit at the store.
Yeah. I can't be too cool with in a tree with my pants down. His dad is big, but I've never seen his face.
Right after he said, I've made mistakes by looking in the wrong window. Excellent.
Would you believe that I, not being a lyrics kid at all, like, it was years before I actually was listening to what he was saying and going, like, holy shit, this is like a silly song.
It didn't click from the title?
No.
I mean, not every title on this album has anything to do with, you know, the song itself, but, like, sometimes it really does.
Yeah, it's, they're telling you right up front. The next one, I guess it applies.
God damn it. That guitar riff is the most iconic pop punk guitar riff.
Gotta be, right?
I'm sure there are...
No, yeah, even more than a later, bigger Blink-182 hit.
Yeah.
It's the most iconic pop punk guitar riff. It's like, it is what broke pop punk as a distinct genre away from just the overall punk revival that was kind of what it was called in 94, because Green Day, but also Rancid and The Offspring, you know, it wasn't all pop punk the way that, like, a band like Blink-182 is very specifically influenced by Green Day more than either of those two other bands, and then also by like the Descendants and NOFX. I retrace the sad look on your face, the timing and structure. Did you hear? You fucked her a day late, a buck short. I'm writing the report on losing and failing. When I move, I'm flailing now, and it's happened once again. I'll turn to a friend. Someone that understands sees through the master plan. But everybody's gone, and I've been here for too long to face this on my own. Well, I guess this is growing up. I mean, the best thing about that song is the keyboards and the is, you know, the really soft keyboards in the middle part.
The breakdown bridge thing.
Yeah, that, like, I remember being on Napster and stuff and finding live versions of it where, like, Mark would do, he would, like, he'd do Ice Ice Baby over it sometimes. I think what we were watching last night, that he was doing No Scrubs over it.
Oh, that rules.
They did the Green Day thing of, like, really leaning into, like, oh, this is our hit. Like, let's, you know, give the audience a big show that they're not going to get from just listening to this on the radio.
Yeah.
Or even just buying the album.
Uh-huh.
And they must have known it was going to be a hit when they recorded it. Otherwise, you know, I don't think there's any keyboards on any other song on this album.
Who didn't do that? I saw Train a couple months ago.
Soul Sister sounded exactly like it did on the radio.
I saw Train.
And
we had to cancel an Alex Jones Sound Massacre show.
We had to cancel Ken for fucking seeing Train.
We were drunk a year and a half ago and we bought tickets for a show that was in a week and then lockdown happened. We were drunk and we were like, thought it'd be funny. And then
Goo Goo Dolls were supposed to be on it, right?
Not that I knew.
Okay, because Train and Goo Goo Dolls.
I would have been hyped about that. Yeah. I wasn't hyped about Train. We just thought it'd be funny because it was like the next week, and then a year and a half later, we get emails that are like, "Hey, you're going to see Train, remember?" We're like, "God damn it!
Can we do Goo Goo Dolls next?"
Yeah, sure.
When we run out of Blink-182 albums.
But Train did not lean into Drops of Jupiter that they closed with. They rushed through. It was a runaway train. They were running off the stage. They did not want to play that song one more time.
Runaway train running off the stage.
They went to a mental
guy's
soul asylum.
Guy's old and resents his old age.
For a long time, if I ever were to jam with new people,
that's
when
the one.
I started playing music and like we didn't know where to start. Everyone knows Damn It, right? Yeah, let's do Damn It.
But you don't know it, it's so easy.
Yeah, if you don't know it, you will learn it.
It's one of the first songs I learned, for sure.
And yeah, Mark apparently wrote it in about as long as it takes to play it.
One of my favorite shows I've ever played was in probably 2009 at the Third Street Co-op in D.C. when I was scheduled to play an acoustic set for some fucking shitty-ass folk punk show. And I was just hanging out at the house beforehand with people that lived there. And we decided to turn my set into just a Blink-182 cover set. And we didn't practice at all. We did Damn It. We did All the Small Things, What's My Age Again, a handful of songs. But it was just, everyone knows Damn It, right?
Mm-hmm.
And everyone in the audience knew it. And it was the first time I really remember like having an audience like sing back to me.
Oh, nice.
And it's just, it is like one of those universally iconic songs.
Yeah, I always think I don't know the words. I know the chorus and he fucked her. And then when it comes on, I suddenly somehow know the words. It's one of those songs that I always think I'm like better than until the second it starts.
Yeah. And you're like, oh, fuck, this goes.
Yeah.
Well, that fucking opening riff just like cuts through like a goddamn buzzsaw. Like the distortion on that guitar is heavenly and just it. Yeah, it's aggressive.
That
it's
early like, Blink tone is.
Yeah. And like it hits the sweet spot of Blink-182. It's like I'm not sad about being broken up with. I'm like pissed about it because all girls hate me, man.
I really imagine every time they heard themselves on the radio with this song, getting really excited that they threw fuck into a radio friendly song.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, they bleeped it. We're getting bleeped.
Fuck yeah.
You don't have a parental advisory sticker on this one. This is the last one before they got them on all of their albums, including
it should have one on it. I mean, I don't.
I mean, yeah. But, like, including the albums, like, now, when no one pays attention to that shit anymore, it's, like, a symbol to them of, like, adolescence.
Uh-huh.
I mean, buying an album with that sticker on it when I was a kid was fucking, like, that sticker made me want to buy an album more.
You're, like, holding the CD and trying to hide the sticker, but it's this CD and you're trying to hide the nutsack with like your thumb on the CD cover. Like, no, it's got this album. It's got, no, it's just got a bull on it.
Doesn't have a parental advisory sticker, but it does have a nutsack.
I remember VH1 produced a TV movie about the PMRC case that led to everyone having to have the
I remember that movie.
It was starring Dee Snider of Twisted Sister.
As himself.
Did he play himself?
He plays himself, yeah. Oh, that's everyone great. Else plays people. Like somebody plays like Tipper Gore, somebody plays Frank Zappa.
I remember they made Zappa out to be just the biggest fucking chode in the world.
He is the biggest chode in the world. Mean, yeah, I love Zappa, but what a fucking asshole.
Yeah, and then I remember thinking it was awesome because I just loved seeing those stickers. I haven't thought about that in years.
Yeah.
They made them so visually appealing.
But Nine had the sticker on it.
That's so funny.
Like, dude, it's 2020. We're
is
past
Nine
that.
The ninth album by Blink-182? It's the one after California?
It's arguable. It depends on whether you consider Buddha or Dogs Eating Dogs. Okay. Also,
what's their math?
Their math is depending, like, their math is if you consider one of those to be an album. It's actually their 12th release.
Okay.
Which,
Did They Came to Conquer Uranus come out before this?
They Came to Conquer Uranus came out before this. That is the first release with the band name Blink-182 on
it. Instead of Blink.
Instead of Blink, yeah. Represses of Cheshire Cat. So between Cheshire Cat and this is when they changed their name to Blink 182.
Because he got thrown with a lawsuit by a band called Blink, right?
Yeah, a Celtic traditional music band.
That's cool.
From Scotland. But
and what are the Blink? And my favorite, like, what is 182? It's obviously just a made up number, but it was the amount of times Mark Hopp has masturbated to Slave Leia.
Yeah. And by the end of this series, that is the amount of times that Mark will have referenced masturbating.
Oh,
yeah.
Shit.
We're on two, and I know that there's several more on this album.
So M&M's.
Yeah. There was another one on Cheshire Cat where he talked about jerking off.
He's about to.
But we're keeping a jerk-off count.
It wouldn't be a podcast on this feed if we didn't talk about Cranking Hog at least a little bit.
This go-round, we're cranking bull, though.
You crank that bull. You!
All right, that's
Moo! Crank that bull.
That's a classic song. And as with a lot of these, or a few of these, the first time I ever heard these was the live version. So I can't hear this song without hearing our intro music.
Take your pants off!
Yeah.
Or, fuck! Just that really good high pitch. Fuck!
Well, the drop.
Yeah, and Tom singing the chorus. Which, like, yeah, Tom has always sung the chorus live.
Oh,
and
it's
yet
so much better.
I don't know why they recorded it without him. But, I mean, think about how, like, Tom is barely on, you know, the lesser single on this album as well. And so, like, they were definitely banking on Mark Hopp as being the, like,
the dude of the ranch.
Well, yeah, like the John Resnick of this band. Like, you're gonna sing the hits.
You know, it's a 50-50 split.
It is, but I kind of think that they were planning on Mark Hopp as being the person who sang their radio songs. And then All the Small Things big as fuck.
That'll be an interesting thing to track. Like, who gets...
That's his only hit on that album.
What?
All the Small Things.
Oh. Is the only Tom DeLonge hit on that album? Yeah, because Mark sings What's My Age Again and Adam Song. Yeah.
We'll continue to track who has more control of the album vocally and otherwise.
And who's cranking their
Well, I think on
lyrics.
I think Cheshire Cat is very clearly Tom-centric.
Mm-hmm.
Just like we're going to keep making the Goo Goo Dolls reference, the first Goo Goo Dolls record, Jed, is mostly Robbie.
Mm-hmm.
You know my obsession with Goo Goo Dolls.
Absolutely, but
I'm noticing way too many similarities now that we've talked about this.
But the fact that, like, I mean, when I first heard the Goo Goo Dolls, like, an album by them, I thought that Robbie sounded like Tom DeLonge slightly. Just higher pitch, scratchier voice.
Can we actually pull up Hey? It is
saying on this farm thing, pull up the song Hey, H-A-Y.
There's a good live one, probably. Yeah, live at the Metro. You've just got that dueling vocal thing. I thought about you just for saying. I almost got cut out in the what to say. Down in the shame, or maybe in the sun. Hey, if you need, I think I got one.
Time. Well, you, and what's on your mind? I'm just wanting
Yeah, no, but the dueling vocals thing, like, that reminds me of Pathetic.
Yeah.
And it's just their trajectory of the, like, secondary singer becoming the lead singer because of the hits.
Yeah.
Is very similar, but, like, that was at their era, their Dude Ranch era, where they were really...
In my Dude Ranch era.
They were really splitting, you know, the songs.
Yeah.
They were, you know, co-vocalists.
Cocalists. Cuckalists.
Cucks. Bunch
we
of
got,
cucks.
We got
some
there.
Good cuck vocals on here.
Cucks.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, let's move on to Boring. A song that describes a song.
No, this song fucking slaps dick.
Killer riff.
Try to wait for me to help you. It's too late for any of my advice. No trust. All I got is lies. Boring. Alright.
It's funny, this sounds a lot like Voyeur, but it's even tighter. And again, they like the guitar and the drums sound really, really good together. There's that little bass solo before the end, the like with that like very similar drums, but you know, that was very similar outro. Clear suggestion of bestiality.
Probably where the album title comes from.
That's a horse, not a bull.
It's on the theme, it's on the hay theme.
Exactly. Sure, yeah. And like, you're right, like, they probably could have cut it.
That's a throwaway song if there ever was one.
I agree.
And to call it Boring.
Maybe it's a good joke.
I mean, that sick guitar riff could have easily been like a bridge in another song.
I go back and forth on that because we're about to hit a few songs where I'm like, there's too many riffs in this fucking song.
No way, dude. These next two are probably my favorites on the album.
Oh, I'm not. I'm talking about a different one. But okay. I mean, we're about to do another song, which I'm surprised like at being able to see the play counts on all these songs. None of them surprised me a whole lot, but I thought this one would have a lot more than it did, especially because it made it onto the live album.
And, yeah.
And because there are higher numbers following Boring.
Mm-hmm. But then here's... I don't know. I like this one a lot. You get some acoustic guitars for probably the first time on a Blink-182 song. And
yeah.
Last time before, like, I fucked it, or I want to fuck a dog.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So Dick Lips is not just a silly throwaway song title. It was an insult that they hurled at a horn player from Real Big Fish.
Good.
All right.
I love this song. It's about him getting kicked out of high school for drinking, and he wrote a song about it, and here it goes. So Tom getting kicked out of high school for drinking at a basketball game.
It's clearly a very formative experience in his life.
Yeah, well, it's what sent him to the school with Mark Hoppus's sister.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
there you go.
That song is kind of the catalyst of Blink-182.
That makes sense why you would mythologize it as much as he did.
Yeah.
And also, yeah, extremely like relatable content there of like anytime I've gotten in trouble for being drunk with
my parents,
like, fuck off. Like, you guys, like, I have seen both of you drunk as shit before.
Yeah.
There have definitely been times or were times in high school where you and I would come back from a trip of running away to New York to see the circus band where this song would go through my head when I got grounded.
Yeah, there's definitely that feeling of like you never did anything really fucking stupid. But this is like the only song where they're singing about being like a dumb teen, and it's definitely not like looking back. It's definitely like singing from the perspective of being that kid. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I always felt like, wow, this like really was mythologized quite a lot. But I guess not even mythologized, but like a formative experience. So I was like, me getting kicked out of high school, also very formative experience, like especially concerning my job and everything. So yeah, I really, really like this song. My favorite thing about it is the way that it has the acoustic guitar holding down the chords in the chorus, so you get that really nice lead going on in the chorus while the acoustic guitars are holding down the chords.
I feel like this song was one that was really well designed for like, it's going to be big when people hear it live. Like they're going to like it a lot on the recording, but when people hear this live, it's going to drive nuts.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's why I love songs that seem to be very acoustic-centric on the album when you hear them live. Because that opening riff sounds really cool on, like, the clean guitar. This is also their last album recorded in standard tuning.
Whoa.
And you could really notice a difference on this song versus live versions of it. Because on the tour for this album, which was called the Poo Poo Pee Pee Tour.
we love the pee pee poo poo language. Hey, Mr. Johnny Pee Pee Poo Poo over here.
Yeah, no, this tour was called the Pee Pee Poo Poo Tour. There are posters and everything. Was when they first tuned down to D standard and later C sharp standard.
What's going on with the drums in that chorus? Are there like brushes?
I think so, yeah. I love me some brushes.
Yeah, it rules. And he does that thing with the nothing to do line where he's doing a counter melody lead on guitar.
That's what I'm talking about. Yeah, that works so well because it's still really full the acoustic guitar's under it.
Yeah.
And I think that this song and the one before Boring, we finally start to get the Tom DeLonge voice. And it was certainly on Cheshire Cat, but Boring, you've got Lies. All I've got is Lies.
Mm-hmm.
Shit, Dad. Like, he's really
least one time.
Well, yeah, if you hear it as whiny, then it works for a song like this really well.
Yeah.
This is definitely one of the first times we get the time.
I'm like just mad at Anthony Jr. right now as I listen to this song because he keeps getting in trouble for getting drunk at school and being a fucking idiot and getting kicked out.
Yeah, the few times I did get in trouble for like being drunk or fucked up, it's like, but you knew I was drunk and fucked up other times and you didn't care at all. So why are you zeroing in on this one?
Yeah, I mean, I find from my experience that sometimes it was like getting caught by somebody else. That's what really pissed my parents off. Like, if they could handle it on their own, that's one thing. But like, you know, getting like, yeah, anywhere like police or like school people are involved, it's like, geez, you know.
Yeah.
But I think that's from just like weird American don't embarrass the family stuff.
Yeah. That's my favorite song on the album.
Same. It's in my top five Blink songs.
Dick Lips is one of your favorite songs by a band.
Yeah, it's up there with Happy Holidays, You Bastard, and Built This Pool.
Well, Built This Pool is one of the best songs by any band.
It's true.
Every time, is that the first time Built This Pool has been brought up on the show?
Yeah, actually.
I feel like it should get played anytime it gets brought up.
You've started it. Here we go. I wanna see some naked dudes. That's why I built this pool. Is that really it?
Moving on to Waggy, which
this song's got a real Built This Pool energy.
Guy who's only heard Built This Pool. Waggy, it was it's the only song re-recorded from They Came to Conquer Uranus. The other two songs are lost to, you know,
Vinyl
Uranus.
LimeWire.
Oh, yeah. Shit.
I love this song.
I was thinking earlier, Blink 182 is intrinsically linked to Napster for me because I didn't discover them till 2001.
Yeah.
I remember the second I saw like the First Date video, I downloaded it.
I was getting Newfound Glory songs labeled as Blink 182. Yeah.
Yeah, they were like the Weird Al of pop punk.
Totally.
Oh, wow.
Like, any parody song got labeled as Weird Al. Like any pop punk song that you get, like, definitely like Bouncing Off the Walls by Sugar Cold, I think got like labeled as a Blink-182 song on Napster.
I'd love to hear Tom sing that one.
Yeah, so did...
I'm bouncing off the walls again.
So did, like, Sum 41. Like, any, like Irish punk band got labeled either Dropkick Murphys or Flogging Molly. They were not by that either of those bands.
What an era of the internet when nothing was checked at all.
You mean the internet?
Yeah.
We weren't fact-checking song names. We're not fact-checking anything else. It's too late.
All right, Waggy.
Is this song going? Just another time that we play this game. I've tried to convince you that things could be different, but somehow they end up the same. But what did you expect from me? What am I supposed to do? You say that you're starting to feel like you're getting lost. Well, I do too. I don't wanna live this lie again.
Jerk off count number three.
Yeah, I mean, so I always thought, I was like, I feel like every lyric before, that's the last line, that's sort of the last line in the song, besides like, it's never over till it's done, and I don't think that you're the one. But I was like, I had the general impression around this song that like every word before that line, I'll just jack off in my room until then, was written with that payoff in mind.
That rules, I love that.
And then I've got something inside. I'll just jack off in my room until then. And no, but then I listened to They Came to Conquer Uranus earlier, and it's I'll just hide in my room until then.
Oh, shit.
And I was like, man, you wrote this whole song and didn't think that, like, I was just like, oh, man, if I had been writing this song, I would have really been waiting to say, I'll just jack off in my room.
Well, no, Eminem's was such a hit that he was like, dude, the masturbation song was a hit.
Yeah.
Let's throw in a jerk off line.
But yeah, that shit, that is a million times better than the Uranus version because of the backing vocals that he adds to it and just the better, you know, recording quality. And but then the next song is also Tom singing his own backing vocals as well, which I, yeah.
Like, which they do a lot and I approve of.
I think they know when it sounds better for them to... here's the thing.
I approve.
Here's the thing. I think there's times where Mark Hoppus should be harmonizing entirely with himself. I feel like you should have Mark Hoppus back up Tom DeLonge whenever you want to.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
I think that always works.
Whoa, we're... This is like meta. Like, you two are... Do this. Like, you two are the two singers.
Oh, just, yeah, probably together. Just, like, no, yeah, when it's like, oh, no, I'm going to handle this one versus, like, when I'm like, actually, no, I want you to back me up and sing the low part.
Oh, certainly. I mean, yeah. I think on Fear of a Flat Planet, there are a lot more, like, Patty songs where Patty's backing Patty up.
Yeah, yeah, and I think we sat down and wrote vocals together a lot more on that second one because we had all that time between recording the music and recording the vocals for sure. Like, you know, lockdown.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We had pretty much most of the music recorded before lockdown and then everything else was vocals and that gave me months upon months to like write many, many vocal parts, know which ones I was going to sing, know which ones everyone else was going to sing.
All right. So we're on to Enthused, which I don't remember.
It's great, but it has too many fucking riffs.
Or no, are we?
Well, yeah, Waggy, we missed the outro to Waggy, which, like, jun. Oh. It's pretty good.
Yeah, those two notes are so effective. And then one note.
I really like, on the Uranus version, I actually do like the way he comes in on it. It's a little more dramatic.
I love They Came to Conquer Uranus. The two songs that didn't make it to this album
are... We'll play the outro part to Uranus here. That's poop.
Outro to my anus.
This show has me saying fart and poop, and I've never said those words around you guys.
This was your idea, not ours.
I needed this show to come out to you guys as a poop and fart sayer.
Good, but I think I had this real problem because I liked songs like this because the guitars were so frenetic, but I was like, where I wanted to have like at least like three riffs played before the singing even started. Mm-hmm. And these days I don't care for that very much. Yeah, especially in my own writing.
This is a 2 minute and 48 second song, and there's a whole minute before anyone starts singing.
I love when it drops out and just am I
am I strung out crazy? You're not allowed to be the one who gets stupid over you. Lazy, laid back, maybe you're just on crack. Why am I the one who gets fucked up and confused?
You're like, oh, this is good. I mean, imagine people who don't like Tom DeLonge's voice just being like,
I don't believe it.
And here I can think of like a few people that like, I could show them this, not tell them it was Blink-182, and like they'd be like, oh, yeah, yep, especially like the drums coming in as like in the, with like the NoFX thing, and then
am I strung out?
Yeah, it's kind of like the same feeling like when Fat Mike starts singing in Linoleum. Like if you don't like Fat Mike's voice, like shit.
Yeah.
Like I don't know, this is their most NoFX sounding song.
Yeah.
In a walk.
It's a good example of what I was trying to say last week about even if he's complaining about stuff with a girl, he's saying he's at fault. Like the lyrics of like
maybe I'm just on crack.
Well, shit. I was thinking more of the chorus where he's just like, I'm the one getting fucked up and stupid over you.
Yeah, it's also one of those things where, like, if this song came out in 2021, like, you're making fun of the crack epidemic, dude. Like,
hey, man,
chill.
That's
like,
not cool.
I didn't even. Okay, not
no, I'm just being.
Yeah.
You know, like it's, it's a time capsule to the fucking 90s. I mean,
saying something. I don't know. People still call people crackheads and don't mean you're actually addicted to drugs. Trust me, that has not gone anywhere. I don't know. It's so funny because the music on this song is like pretty incredible. The lyrics are like some of Tom DeLonge's weakest lyrics he's ever fucking written in his life, and like. They are not strong lyric writers as much as they can write good hits.
Yeah, I was thinking like about some of the later songs on the album. I'm not like
those are the better ones. The ones about like tipping cows and getting butt fucked in prison. Something again you would not joke about in 2021.
True. Yeah, exactly. All right, should we do Untitled?
Yeah, this song's good. It's got the good skit and everything at the end of it. But again, I'm very shocked at how like, it's not. I thought this was a much bigger song on this album. It's
this
like
was
the second
on the live album too, right?
It was, yeah. Maybe they just knew like which song. It's funny that they added like so is Voyeur, so is and like these are some of the least popular songs play wise on this
because
album
everyone's
Spotify.
Listening to them on the live album.
It's very possible.
All right, let's hear their Alex Jones Style Massacre cover.
It's not a change of pace. This time I'll get it right. Not a change of taste. I was the one there last night. You had your other friends. They were there when you cried. Didn't mean to hurt you then. Best friend just won't leave your side. But what do I get? Does I just seem to lose? You made me regret those times I spent with you. And playing those games as I wait for your call. Now I give up, so goodbye and so long. This time I'll get it right. It's not a change of taste. I was the one there last night. When I needed you most, when I needed a friend, you let me down now like I let you down then. So sorry, it's over.
The first leitmotif of
So Sorry It's Over.
Yeah. No, I
I never caught that until I was listening for this.
Yeah, no, I often wonder who this song is about. I mean, the tensions were already there when they were recording this album. They were recording it with injuries because the fucking drummer was too drunk and jumped off, sat on a ledge, begged you to come down.
Interesting.
So sorry, it's over. The lyrics of that one song, Man Overboard, that is openly about their drummer. And then you have a callback to this song.
Whoa.
In it. I mean, this album was recorded with some serious tension going on, which we'll see on multiple Blink albums, that there is, like, you know, shit going on between the members that
affects the music, like, yeah, way more than...
and affects the lyrics.
That's so interesting.
Yeah, it's not all, like, yeah, they really only hit with The Clash for, like, their biggest song ever, which is funny.
Which one?
Oh, Should I Stay or Should I Go?
Yeah.
But, like, yeah, it can't not affect the lyrics and the music, like, tensions going on with the band.
Good time while we're talking about band tensions to talk about the most recent Blink-182 drama that has just dropped.
Go ahead.
Matt Skiba, no longer in Blink-182.
Is that true?
Well, we don't know, but they're playing shows without him.
Whoa.
What does that mean, without him?
So, Blink-182 on Halloween at some Travis Barker house party show that was streamed live, Blink-182 played a set with a mysterious man in a astronaut costume.
No way.
What? Yeah.
Without Matt Skiba? Without Matt Skiba.
Well, Matt Skiba was playing a show with Alkaline Trio across the country.
Right.
Whoa.
But the masked person was wearing a astronaut suit.
Yeah, who did it sound like?
Well, they only did Rock Show, Age Again, and Family Reunion.
Oh my god.
That's funny.
Yeah.
That rules.
Yeah. But also, okay, it was not Tom, obviously, because Tom was also across the country playing a show at the Norva in Virginia.
Whoa.
Oh, yeah.
So, no, I would love for it to but have it been could Tom be DeLonge.
A representation.
It could be a representation.
It could be anyone.
Tom wants us to be asking the questions.
It's worth playing the clip if you can find it.
Okay, I will.
But like the reason they did it was clearly because Mark Hoppus is cancer-free now. Fuck yeah.
Yeah.
I took her out. It was a Friday night. I walk alone to get the feeling right. We started making out, and she took off my pants, but then I turned on the TV, and that's about the time she walked away from me. So why do you like she went in 23? And I still more amused by TV shows. What the hell is in me? My friends say I treat that mage. What's my age again? What's my age again?
It was a comeback. And his voice is auto-tuned. It's very clear. But, like, dude just got out of fucking chemo. Yeah. So he gets a pass.
Hell yeah.
But it's awesome. It's really fun to watch. And whoever is under that astronaut costume had to have had a fucking blast.
Oh, I bet.
But it has led to some heated discussion of, is Matt Skiba still in the band? And the use of the fucking astronaut costume.
Seriously.
Yeah.
It's like, that's not an accident.
No,
it's a choice.
Isn't. Yeah.
So what do you think?
I don't know, man. I mean, I definitely... So Mark and Tom were on Mark's radio show recently talking just about early days of Blink-182. Tom is shooting a movie currently, and he was talking about how a lot of the dialogue came from early Blink-182 jokes, which definitely has me concerned about the quality of that. But you could really hear in their discussion that they were kind of reconciling a lot of shit on the air.
Wow.
And Boxcar Racer has a new EP coming out next year in celebration of the 20-year anniversary of Boxcar Racer's first album. So you've got Travis and Tom working together. And then two nights ago at a show in D.C., Tom comes on stage before the encore and talks about his best friend beating cancer. Whoa. And goes right into, "Where are you?" and plays "I Miss You."
Wow.
And like I said in the first episode, there's definitely a chance of us getting halfway through this podcast and some big fucking shit breaking. And it took till episode two.
Till making this podcast.
Yeah.
You too.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
It's cool.
Yeah. I'm looking forward to tracking this as we move forward.
Blink Watch.
Apple Shampoo Poo.
This song is Tour. The best song on the album. It's one of the best songs by Blink 182. I'll never be that cool. I never wanted to hold you back. I just wanted to hold on. But my chance is gone. I know just where I stand. A boy trapped in the body of a man. And I'll take what you're willing to give. And I'll teach myself to live. With a walk-on part of a background shot from a movie online.
What a great line. And then
she's so important. And I'm so retarded.
Same people that put an album out on Faggots in the Wilderness. That is peak Mark Hoppus.
Yeah, that is actually really incredible how he followed probably the best lyric he had written to date with the worst lyric he had written to date. Neither of them about jacking off.
Do you know who this song's about, Patty?
Who is it about?
Elise Rogers of the Dance Hall Crashers.
Oh, that's very, very interesting. Yeah. Both getting tired of punk rock clothes. That's just a good song about being in your early 20s and playing in bands. And that's probably why it stayed one of my favorite songs by this band, like well into like early adulthood, is because it is such a, like, I just liked the song initially. Like, I liked the clever turn of phrase and that really good line. Like, I'll take what you're like, I know just where I stand, a boy trapped in the body of a man. And I'll take what you're willing to give, teach myself to live with a walk-on part in a background shot of a movie I'm not in. It's very, very, very good. And then another line that you would not write 25 years later.
Which is a shame because I know I'm never going to see them play that song.
Yeah, it doesn't even rhyme.
I mean, like, I could totally see, like...
I want to believe that's an intentional, that makes it funny.
I want to...
He's like, LOL, this doesn't rhyme.
Believe that, like, Skiba 182, because I feel like that was very much an attempt to, like, recapture the adolescence of that was... I could see them... And I just farted. Rhymes the same way. I could see them pulling that one off. But that's a great song that I don't think they play live ever.
See if there's a live video of that song.
Oh, shit. We got a 2013.
Okay, well, let's see if they keep the line in 2013.
Because this would have been too late to still sing that line.
I was saying I'm excited about your next song.
We haven't played this next song in about 12 years, so.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah, do commentary.
This is a rough era of Blink 182.
Yeah, it makes me wonder if Travis ever even learned this song when he first joined the band.
Well, no, he had to have because he's the touring drummer of Dude Ranch.
That is true. The guitar line on the song is so very, very good, though.
Mm-hmm.
Man.
That lingering fifth, that like where he changes the root note.
This is like Tom DeLonge on a shitload of dope.
Oh, this is when he's on all the Vicodin?
Still nailing this. Yeah.
He's not singing at all. He's in the zone. It's when he has to sing and play guitar.
Is he hitting the pedal board on this fucking shit?
Oh, yeah. He's got that Van Halen flanger going hard. Mark's having a rough night here.
I'd be having fun.
Yeah.
It sounds good.
Sounds fine.
Yeah.
Andrew. Let's go. I'm so
unguarded. Unguarded. There you go. Holy shit. It's another example of people trying to be PC.
PC culture and coming to ruin the best Blink-182 lyric. Yeah. That's what I meant.
No. I've been thinking a lot lately about Fairy Tale in New York.
I know you have. Yeah.
I know. I'm a cheap lazy faggot. You're like,
if another neurotypical person says I can't say the R word. Don't care, didn't ask, plus you're neurotypical. No, I feel like, yeah. It's good that that word is out of polite society.
Yeah.
And, like, it's a weird hill that a lot of, like, people want to die on. The trick is getting, like, a token autistic or maybe two token autistic people in your group chat.
Yeah.
And then you get licensed to say the R word whenever you feel like it, they're cool with it.
You're not going
to
believe this.
Just got back from the doctor.
Yeah, exactly.
Guess you can say the R word now.
I was at that show.
And you didn't recognize that they played it? It wasn't a big deal to you at the time?
Wheel Turn, where's that?
Mm-mm. It's at Los Angeles. This is
Ken's LA era.
This is my 2 weeks in LA. This was when they did the full self-titled album from start to finish.
That's why they had that background.
And that's part of the encore.
10th anniversary, probably. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Very cool. I was wondering about the background.
For the encore, they did Damn It and Family Reunion. But LL Cool J came out during Damn It.
Oh, I thought you were going to say during Family Reunion.
That would have been better.
It was Damn It was the second to last song, and then Family Reunion they closed on. I wonder if LL Cool J just hung out on stage for those 40 seconds.
He could learn the lyrics pretty fast.
They opened with it the first time I saw them.
I don't know. Mark's flow in Family Reunion is unmatched, dude. Yeah, I was at that show. That's so nuts. I didn't see the date when we first looked at it.
All right, we're on to emo, which meant a very different thing in 1996.
I like this one a lot. It's good harmonizing from Mark and Tom.
Yeah.
This Mark very down bad on this song though.
Very what?
He's down bad. Like he's like sad about a. Actually, no, because like what I like about this song is he's not like pining for the girl he's telling. Like he's telling a girl that her boyfriend sucks and that she should leave him, but not in a like
I'm better. I'm the one.
Yeah, he's
been there for you all along.
Yeah, I am the one. Yeah, not in that kind of way. Just in a you deserve better type thing.
Yeah. There's some good Tom Mark harmonies on this song.
Oh yeah, I love when he pops in near the end. Tom, I forget what it is exactly.
Because she fell right. Yeah, shit's good. On the floor, because she fell right off when all you said. Lingering on that one note is just some good. I'm so interested to. Like, yeah, probably listen to Enema of the State when I drive home tonight to try and pick out, like, the big, big differences. Because it's not just a different drummer, and it's not just a change in subject matter. It is Tom's playing.
It's Jerry Finn.
Mm.
And we'll get to that, but he was the fourth member of Blink. She's better
off sleeping on. This shit rules.
More Jawbreaker shit.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. She's better off sleeping on the floor. She's better off sleeping on the floor. Is it a Jawbreaker influence or is it a Jimmy World influence? Just a band that is extremely influenced by Jawbreaker themselves.
You know, honestly, yeah, with the guy doing Static Prevails right before this.
Exactly, yeah.
Yeah. Good song.
Good song.
Third, no, wow. Fourth least played on this album of 15 songs.
Josie, when I see this song is coming up and I know it's Blink-182, I expect online songs every time.
It's just because it's the opening lyric.
Uh-huh.
But again, I like this song a lot. Because
that was my first Blink album.
Right. I like this song a lot because it's about, it's like another song. It's like Apple Shampoo. It's a song about being like a broke young adult musician, but it's the opposite. Instead of being about a breakup, it's about like how cool your girlfriend is when you're like, yeah. Which having a cool girlfriend is a pretty important part of being like a young musician.
Yeah.
Josie is also Elise Rogers from the Dance Hall Crashers.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah. My girlfriend likes UL and DHC.
She's in DHC.
Unwritten Law and Dance Hall Crashers.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah, I knew that those were references to those bands, but I didn't realize that he dated one of the singers.
Very cute song.
Yeah.
Just
the line about how he doesn't have a very big dick is good.
Yeah.
I don't have a bulge.
Doesn't seem to matter. I'm lacking in the bulge.
Scott Rainer's a little incessant for me in this. I wish he'd follow the chug.
I like the syncopation of his drums on this album a lot. He's in the pocket.
He is in the pocket.
I think She's Still Up Watching Vacation. Definitely, like, I don't know why, but I connect Blink-182 to, like, National Lampoon humor.
I think Mark Hoppus has a Chevy Chase energy.
Yeah, but with less racism.
No, like likable, like Chevy Chase. Like Clark Griswold is like a likable but frustrating character.
Dude, there's the dog
Fletch.
Sketch.
He's like Fletch.
The dog sketch on here is it's the joke the longest pee from the Adam Sandler album, and his voice he does after it is so Sandler. I guess we'll hear it later. Yeah. But it hit me when I heard it. I was like, oh. He has huge Sandler influence, too.
Blink-182 and Adam Sandler are like
the same generation
peak
of
juvenilia.
Yeah.
Boys trapped in the body of men.
Totally. Yeah, this is Billy Madison's favorite album. Everything's gonna be fine.
Those bass chords again.
Yeah. Is this the second most played on the album?
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, it's the other single.
Yeah. It was like the fourth single, but the second biggest song.
Interesting. I didn't know there were any other singles off this.
I forget what the other two were listed as.
Maybe Waggy, actually. I think maybe they were all Mark songs.
Yeah, wow. All right, I love this song.
If it weren't about Star Wars, would you love this song, though?
I don't care.
It is about Star Wars, and I love it.
Thank you. I think, and this is a couple years before the saga begins, I think Weird Al is tuned into the comedy music at the time.
Well, do you know what else was happening in 1996? Do you remember 1996?
Well, Shadows of the Empire?
Oh, no. I remember...
The remastered.
Yeah, 1996 is a very formative year.
Oh, yeah. I had those VHSs. Exactly.
I saw the remasters in theaters. Mm-hmm.
The remasters, I think, are the, like... Probably just because they came out when I was seven. But, like, the remasters, I think, are the best versions. I wish I still had those VHSs.
Oh, we're talking about the ones where he added stuff. Those came out in theaters.
I thought that was later.
No, those came out in 96.
Yeah, might have been the end of 96 and one was in the beginning of 97 or something.
I'm thinking of the early 90s then, just having like...
VHS, the one with Yoda and
Vader
the Stormtrooper.
Yeah, because those
are the best.
Yeah, because all they do is update the special effects. Uh-huh. They don't add anything. They just update the special effects, make it look better.
Yeah.
I have the theatrical versions on DVD. That's fine, too. Because they still look great.
Mm-hmm.
But it's different.
Yeah. No, I'm with you.
Give me that full screen. Give me that fucking Vader VHS.
I love seeing all the three
lightsabers
of them
look sick.
Oh, yeah.
The Death Star exploding is the best it ever looked.
Oh, yeah. And I'm glad we're having this conversation over the song.
Yes. The line about drinking Colt 45s with Lando.
Yeah.
And the way he says Mos Eisley is very, very good.
Yeah. And he says he should be an Alderaanian, like you.
Alderaanian. Very good. I don't even know if anyone says Alderaanian in the films. Like, it takes you a second to be like, oh, Alderaan, got it.
The planet blew up. Who would they be referring to?
He used to get a bass solo every other song.
These really tough bass solos.
Yeah, never really did much with them.
And yeah, Tom just hits it with all the hammer-ons and pull-offs all over this album, but it just sounds so good.
Cause, his guitar tone is so much better than the last time.
Yeah, he just knows his scales really, really well.
It's all stuff, like, he's playing stuff that could ostensibly be in metal songs. He's just hitting notes that make it poppy.
No, they're not at all technically difficult to play.
Yeah, but I'm just saying.
Some of his riffing, like, could work, but yeah, I know what you mean. But also, like, I had maybe been playing guitar for, like, less than a year when I was learning how to play all of these songs.
Yeah.
So they're just good for that.
Oh, totally.
I really just don't have any thoughts about this song.
Would you talk about Star Wars?
I mean, yeah, sure.
Too late.
Too late. Best song of the album's coming up.
This is from Flyswatter. This is a re-recording from their first demo.
Interesting.
Off Fags in the Wilderness Records.
Whoa.
It's true.
I know. I'm just saying. My friend and I used to sing this all the time when we were like shitty kids.
I love the groove. A star in the door slam. No noise, just silence is a scream. My dick was slammed out of prison for 1 month. No one to see. All I got is guy. Bend over. Going cash, going bad. People tell me she's bad. I'm a jerk. I'm a punk. Took a shower because it comes from the bunk. Feel like that. And my nose, I kept my rap. And my dude wore a thong. For a hobby of the gun.
You can tell it's the CD era of music because the last three songs have the least plays and are kind of the worst songs on the album.
Just hard disagree with, because Lemmings is great.
Another re-recording from Flyswatter.
Wow.
And it's
these
own
two
single
songs,
they,
yeah.
They recorded Lemmings several times because there's a Lemmings 7-inch.
It's on
as
Buddha.
Well. No, it's not, but there's a, not? There's, okay. there's a Lemmings 7-inch. Dee-dee-dum. We don't have to keep listening to this. Okay. I was like, there's more? What the hell else goes on in this song? Just thought it was like, cross the street, naked at night. I'm like, that's funny.
Bend over to shed some moonlight, yeah.
Felt a 12-gauge in my bit of hum, dee dee da. He has a gun put up his butt. It's funny.
But I didn't.
He went to a farm to tip some cows.
I didn't learn any of that until listening to this over the last week.
Yeah, song slaps.
Yeah, I like this song a lot. Again, another song about, like, being... I don't know. Like, yeah, the best songs on this album hit that, like, young, broke musician vibe. I came to the light, feeling that singing pride is fucking with me. It's fucking with you. Counter melody on the guitar.
Uh-huh.
This line of words on the back of flyers.
Flyers
You want to know who opened for the Poo Poo Pee Pee Tour?
I was going to ask earlier.
It wasn't the Aquabats, was it?
It's a long list.
Who did it include the Aquabats?
Yes, the Aquabats were definitely a portion of it. We've got the Aquabats for the majority of the tour. We've got the Ataris.
Yeah, that's how it happened.
MXPX.
The Ataris, MXPX.
Jimmy Eat World.
Yep.
The Vandals.
Yep.
Unwritten Law. Assorted UL. Jelly Beans.
Whoa.
Real Big Fish.
Dick Lifts.
Frenzel Romb.
Who?
Frenzel Romb.
Okay.
They were on some Punk-O-Ramas.
Interesting.
And a big thing is a lot of these bands were on Epitaph.
Yeah.
Which is who Scott wanted them to sign to, which was one of the first points of contention for the band, is that Epitaph and MCA both approached them, and Scott was upset they decided to not go with Epitaph.
Dude, I mean, Blink-182's rise in popularity, like, there were plenty of, like, people in, like, underground, even Epitaph, like, level punk saying, like, this band is, like, really juvenile and misogynist, and we don't really appreciate, you know, that people are considering them, like, you know, the heralds of this new era of punk.
Yeah.
I don't think they would have gone over well at Epitaph.
It wouldn't have worked out,
no.
Yeah. I almost never make it to this song.
It's worth it to listen to the end.
I mean, it's pretty funny that the last song on the album is an apology.
We're sorry. Wait.
Don't
bide your time.
Time. We need a time counter, too.
It's called a clock, you mean? You motherfucker, it's called a clock.
I hope you stayed through this episode for that joke, everybody. I hope you made it this far.
Hope you are. Now you are not sorry. You'll do
it once. I'm getting serious, like, Sunny Day Real Estate vibes.
Bam, bam. See, the syncopated drums and guitar on this album really fucking kill it.
Yeah.
They try it on the Cheshire Cat. It just doesn't work as well because they're not as tight.
True. Yeah, and they just toured nonstop between these, so they're way tighter than...
Well, yeah, and they're doing Warp Tour. They're like,
they're kind of the first Warp Tour band. They were the band that, like, because Warp Tour is what got them where they were.
Absolutely, you know? Yeah. It always seemed like such a dream. That's a lot of the early Napster recordings were them live at Warp Tour. And
yep.
Thinking Warp Tour would be a cool place to go and being incredibly mistaken. The one year I was like, all right, let's do it. Like,
you only went once?
Dude, I was thoroughly, like, disgusted. I was just...
What year?
It was like 2003 or 2004, and I was like, this sucks. I can't walk anywhere without somebody trying to sell me something.
Mm.
Fuck this. Like, and...
I went 03, 04, and 06.
I went... The only year I stayed all day, I think, was, like, 03 or 04. And then I went to, like, a few others just to see, like, someone set. Like, Sum 41, usually.
I had a good time. I saw Tiger Army, like, famously tell the crowd to give the middle finger to the sun because they're a spooky band. And it was hot outside, so they don't like sunlight. And they played Power of Moonlight and told everybody to give the middle finger to the sun. It's still one of the, like, most lasting cringe moments of my life. I think I brought it up on the last podcast.
It's worth repeating.
Yeah, like, POV, you're at a show, you're at Warped Tour in 2003, and the lead singer of the band is wearing goth makeup, even though there's an upright bass on stage. And he's telling the crowd to give the middle finger to the sun.
The bonus track on O Calcutta by the Lawrence Arms is a dig at Warped Tour, because the Lawrence Arms was on
that song
tour
kicks ass
for a week and cut the fuck out. They were like, this sucks. But my favorite, it starts with the line, it's burning a fire inside that I just can't believe. And it's just, and like, there are references to all the bands that were on the tour. It has my favorite line of any song ever. The fringe is the center. Hey now, that's great. Just fucking, we're like selling what was counterculture as culture.
Uh-huh.
And it feels like a very big dig at Blink-182 specifically.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, I mean, I think, yeah. I had a good enough time, but knew that I never wanted to do that again.
We've got some fade out here. Is this the bit?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it's got some feedback, fade out into some feedback into piss.
Piss.
Piss, everybody. And this is how they chose to end their major label debut. Wait. Does it not include it on Spotify?
Oh, fuck that.
Wait, wait, go back. Go back. Yeah, yo, bring it back. Bring it back. No, I think that's what happened.
It's not there. Who's on it on my phone?
Denied. Wait, what, really?
Yeah.
No stairway.
Denied. Yeah, no, it's definitely not on this.
No piss joke. I guess we'll have to listen to Adam Sandler's.
Hey, man, let me in there first.
Go ahead, man. Take it easy.
Thanks. I really gotta pee.
In your pants.
I know.
So did I.
I guess that makes us piss pals.
When I was in third grade, I found that very funny. And that's what the piss joke that we didn't get to hear from Spotify reminds me of.
Well, that was certainly an album.
Oh, yeah, Dude Ranch?
It's a good album.
Oh, yeah.
No, it's my favorite.
Yeah, no worries.
I loved it.
We're about to enter the golden age of Blink, although we might have already, but that's the early Blink. Scott has now left the band. The drummer of the Aquabats has joined. Travis learned all of the songs in 45 minutes before his first set with the band. Travis was in the band for 2 months, and then they played one final show with Scott, and that was it.
Yeah, I mean, so what did they do? Because we were talking about it earlier, and it's like, it seemed like they were going to, like, have to find a new drummer, but how did they do it? They kind of did it in a pretty dickish way, if I'm not mistaken.
Well, yeah, so basically...
Oh, told him he had to go to rehab, and he did, and they still fired him?
Yeah, so yeah. They told him he had to go to rehab because he had become such a problem drinker, and he agreed to go. But they fired him anyways because... And look, it sounds like a dick thing. It really does. But Travis had replaced him on many occasions already. And Scott wanted to go to college. And Blink-182 was on the verge of being the biggest band.
He was going away to college?
Yeah.
Whoa.
No, they were on the verge of being the biggest band in the world, and to wait for your drummer to get out of rehab?
Yeah.
I get it, but it sucks.
Yeah.
And Scott has, you know, gone on the record that he was bummed, but he didn't blame them. And I don't think I do either. I mean, this album fucking blew up, and they had to tour for it. And they had songs to write, and they went on to become the biggest band in the world for a hot minute.
And that's the next episode, which you guys are definitely going to enjoy. I mean, I'm going to go listen to what, you know, made them the biggest band in the world on my way home.
Yeah.
Yeah. And, of course, you can hear Patrick, as well as Ripley, as well as myself, on all of the Alex Jonestown Massacre recordings. And don't forget to listen to Patrick on his very own show, It Can Be Done. Great show. A Marxist podcast where praxis guides theory, and obviously theory guides praxis. This ruled revisiting this because, unlike the albums that follow it, I hadn't listened to this in a very long time.
Yeah.
Like the following ones I go back to.
I'm very excited for the next three episodes. Next four episodes.
Me too.
Five, six. Because we're going to do Boxcar Racer too, right?
Sure.
Yeah. That's going to be a fun one.
You guys have to do Plus 44.
Oh yeah. I think that we'll do like a Plus 44 Angels and Airwaves episode and cover the two. Because those are both 2006.
Yeah. But that's a plus 226 episode. Because that's 182 plus 44.
Aha!
Can I make it every episode?
Yeah.
Stay tuned.
We hope.
You had the time of fucking a dog in the ass. No, don't use that. Use
it. We're using it.
Well, I guess this is growing up. Well, I guess this is growing up. Well, I guess this is growing up.